So in the last class, we have discussed about the simple RC low-pass filter circuit and characterized the properties of the circuit by means of a function which is known as a transfer function. And in fact, we have also calculated the higher cutoff frequency pertaining to the particular circuit. Now today, our plan is to identify the output response resulting from that circuit whenever some well-known input signal is being provided to this RC circuit. So to start with, let me just once again draw the circuit which we have discussed in the last class. It's a simple RC network consisting of a resistance and a capacitor. And we have identified that this network will act like a low pass filter. That means when the signal frequency is small, then it can pass the corresponding signal value. And as the signal frequency increases, the attenuation increases. And as a matter of fact, the gain reduces. And we have established that the higher cutoff frequency, FH, was given by 1 upon twice pi RC. So as this product R and C increases, the higher cutoff frequency will reduce and vice versa. So FH and this RC, these two parameters, they are inversely proportional to each other. Now today, our first input signal, that I'm going to apply to this RC low-pass network is a simple unit step function. So as you know, for any step function, it looks something like that. It's the kind of input signal which exists only for t greater than or equal to zero. Normally, it is represented by some ut, unit step function, and the value is equal to 1. For t greater than or equal to 0. So we define like ut, that is unit step function, that is equal to 1 for t greater than or equal to 0, and that is equal to 0 for t less than 0. In fact, one can produce this unit step function from unit impulse function itself just by finding out the corresponding integration, because if you integrate a unit impulse function from 0 to say capital T or 0 to say T, then you'll be getting what is known as the step function. Or in other words, if you just think in that way, that in discrete time also, the unit impulse is given like delta n is equal to 1 for n is equal to 0, and that is 0 for n not equal to 0. And in discrete time domain, un is given like un is equal to 1 for n greater than or equal to 0 and 0 for n less than 0. So you can easily identify that un can be easily obtained from delta n using that function, that in discrete time domain, un can be written like so summation over delta k for k ranging from minus infinity to n. So that is the description, that is the relationship between the delta function and the step function in the discrete time domain. And as you know, if we want to move from the discrete time domain to the continuous time domain, then this summation sign will be replaced by the integration sign. So that is all about the unit step function. And if I would like to provide a step function where the amplitude is not equal to 1, rather some fixed value like say, so in that case, you'll find that we can write the corresponding signal Vt as V times Ut. What I mean to say is that if the signal looks something like that.
Sir.
Yes.
স্যার একটা প্রবলেম হয়ে গেছে, আমার ভাইকে হঠাৎ করে হসপিটালাইজড করতে হয়েছে, আমি কি বেরোবো ক্লাস থেকে? মানে ইমিডিয়েট একটা ব্যাপার হয়ে গেছে আর কি,
Sure, no
হঠাৎ করে
problem.
মাথা ঘুরে গেছে।
Yes, sure, no problem.
আমি
You
স্যার
may
তাহলে
leave.
বেরিয়ে যাচ্ছি। হ্যাঁ
Mm-hmm.
ওকে স্যার।
So let's consider this signal. So let it be presented by some, say, VIT, the input signal. And suppose here the peak is equal to V. So we can write that VIT can be written as V times the unit step function. So if I apply this unit step function to this RC network, one can easily find out what is the corresponding output voltage. Now, instead of applying a simple unit step function, we can also apply a function like VIT, because last day we have seen that this network, this RC network, is basically a linear network as far as the organization of this R and C components are concerned, and as far as the properties of R and C elements are concerned. So therefore, since it's a linear network, so obviously it will follow the property of additivity and the property of homogeneity. So instead of applying UT, one can also apply VIT, for which the amplitude equal to V for t greater than or equal to 0, and that is equal to 0 for t less than 0. Now suppose whenever we apply this signal VIT over here, and let us assume that the current that is flowing, let this be represented by IT. So although VIT is constant for t greater than or equal to 0, but we can always represent this VIT, I mean this input signal, as a function of t. So that's why I've written like VIT. You may argue that, okay, for t greater than 0, it's a constant, so it's not a function of time. But anyway, but we can always represent this V in as a function of t. So accordingly, the current that is flowing through the circuit is also a function of time. And we can apply the Kirchhoff's voltage law in this particular loop to write down the corresponding expression. So how can this be written, this Kirchhoff's voltage law, KVL? So if I apply KVL over here, let me go to the next slide, and it says that VIT, input signal, is equal to R into IT, the voltage drop across the resistance, plus the voltage drop across the capacitor. So 1 by C, integration over IT dt. Now we can differentiate both sides of this equation with respect to time. And then we are left with dVIT dt. That is equal to R dIT dt. Plus IT by C. Now our input signal looks something like that, which is constant for t greater than or equal to 0. So that is my input signal VIT, which is constant, kept constant at VIT is equal to V, capital V. So this dVIT dt will be equal to 0 for t greater than 0. So this is equated to 0 is equal to R dIT dt plus IT by C. Now this is a linear differential equation. One can solve being in the natural domain, being in the time domain, or for the sake of the calculation, let us go to the transform domain, that is in the Laplace domain. So if I apply the Laplace transform over here, we'll be getting like, if I applying Laplace transform, so that this differentiation operation will be transformed into simple algebraic equation. So applying Laplace transform, we are getting like, so dit dt, it will give you s is minus I0 plus. So what is meant by I0 plus? This is nothing but the current value at t is equal to 0 plus. That means when the time instant is just greater than 0. So that is the value of the current, that is I0 plus. So that came directly from the property of the Laplace transform. So R SIS minus I0 plus, plus you have IS upon C. That is equated to 0. So what I mean to say is that Laplace transform of IT, so IT, small IT, is in the natural time domain. And if you transform it into the Laplace domain, then it is represented by I of S. So from that, if I take this I of S common in one side, we'll be having like IS S R plus 1 by C minus R into I0 plus. Minus, so that can be equated to I0 plus multiplied with simply R. So from that, what we can do is we can represent I0 plus as a function of I of S. So I0 plus can be represented as a function of I of S. So I0 plus can be written like, remember this I0 plus is a constant quantity, it's not a function of time. So that can be written like I of S into SR plus 1 by C divided by R, that is equal to IS into S plus 1 by RC. So that is the most convenient form to calculate S plus 1 by RC. So ultimately we have got like I0 plus is given by IS times S plus 1 upon RC. Then you have to identify what about the I0 plus. So what is meant by I0 plus? This is nothing but the current that is flowing through the circuit at t is equal to 0 plus. So if I assume that the initial voltage across the capacitor, the initial voltage across the capacitor, if I call this initial voltage like VC initial, let this be V dashed. So this is the initial voltage across the capacitor or initial output voltage at t is equal to 0 plus. Then what about the I0 plus? So this is nothing but the difference between these two upon R. So at this point, you have the voltage of V. At this node, you have a voltage of V dashed. And in between these two nodes, you have a resistance R. So I0 plus will be equal to V minus V dashed by R. That is the expression for I0 plus. So we can write I0 plus, that means the current component at t is equal to 0 plus. And 0 plus means when the time is just greater than 0. So that is equal to V minus V dashed divided by R, where we can consider V dashed is the initial voltage across the capacitor. Initial voltage across the capacitor. Or you can also call V dash is the initial output voltage. So I naught I zero plus is equal to v minus v dash by r. So from that, I mean, in the last slide, we have got like I zero plus is equal to, is given by I s times s plus 1 upon rc. So now we can represent I s as a function of v, v dash, r, c, and s. And that is given by v minus v dashed upon r into s plus 1 upon rc. So for the sake of analysis, let me once again draw the circuit over here so that I cannot refer back always to the previous slide. The same circuit. So the current that is flowing is IT in the natural time domain. The input signal is VT. And the output is V out or V out T. So now already we have got the expression for IS. Then in the natural time domain, this V in and V out, they are separated by the voltage drop across the resistance. So one can say that V in T or V I T, I don't know whether I have represented, yeah, it was V in. So let me make it consistent, so it should be V in. Anyway, so this is V in T. So V in T is equal to R I T plus V out T. And we are interested in finding out V out T. So V out T is given by the output voltage as a function of time is given by V in T minus R I T. So once again, if I apply the Laplace transform, so applying Laplace transform, so what you are getting is V out S. So we are applying Laplace transform in both sides of the equation. It's given by V in S minus R into I S. So what is the expression for V in S? Because V in, as you have seen, V in is nothing but the input signal, which is equal to a scaled step function. It looks something like that. V in T, I think I should be consistent here also. It should be V in T. So V in T is equal to V for T greater than or equal to zero and zero otherwise. So therefore, if you apply the Laplace transform over V in T, it will give you V upon S. So it will give you V upon S. So this is V upon S minus RIS. So RIS, you can calculate directly from this equation. So RIS is nothing but V minus V dashed upon S plus 1 by RC. So it makes the complication, I mean, if you have any complicated calculations, so these complications are removed because you have moved from the natural time domain to the Laplace domain, to the transform domain. And now once again, you can apply the inverse Laplace transformation. So Laplace inverse. And then you can easily find it out, V out T. So this is given by V into UT, I should write UT, V into UT minus V dashed and 1 upon S plus 1 by RC. If we take the inverse Laplace transform, then it will give you e to the power minus T by RC. So if I would like to write down the expression for V out T for T greater than 0 or T greater than equal to 0, so the expression for V out T is given by v minus v minus v dashed into e to the power minus p by rc. And that is true for t greater than or equal to 0. So generically, that can also be represented like, so V is the final targeted output voltage that the capacitor is going to achieve. So that can be also written like V final minus V final minus V dash is the initial voltage across the capacitor. So V initial into e to the power minus t by rc. Now to make things simple, let us assume that v initial is equal to 0. Now with v initial is equal to 0 or v dash is equal to 0, then this v out t expression for the v out t is pretty simple, and that is equal to v into 1 minus e to the power minus t by rc. That is the most convenient form for this RC network. So V out T for T greater than or equal to 0, with the initial voltage across the capacitor being 0, that means initially the capacitor is uncharged, that is equal to V times 1 minus e to the power minus T by RC. So let me first draw the variation of this output voltage with respect to time. How does it look like? I think it will be better if I draw the input and the output together. That will be better, I think. So let me take two different color for that. So that is the input voltage that we're applying, and that will is equal to V, and the output voltage looks something like that, V into 1 minus e to the power minus t by rc. So you may understand that when the value of t is equal to 0 or very small, even with t is equal to 0, then V out t is equal to 0. In this particular equation, if t is equal to 0, that means at this particular point, the output voltage is equal to 0. V multiplied with 1 minus 1, that is equal to 0. Even if you consider this particular equation where the V initial is not equal to 0, here also you'll find that if I put the value t is equal to 0, small t is equal to 0, then this expression is finally reduced to v final minus v initial. So that is equal to v initial. With v initial is equal to 0, v out t will be equal to 0. And then if the value of t is very large, and if I assume that this t by rc, this ratio is much, much larger, let it be say 5 or 10, and then this e to the power minus 5, e to the power minus 10 can be neglected with respect to 1. And then ultimately V out T will be equal to V. So going back to the circuit once again, if I just once again go back to the circuit, initially let us assume that the output, I mean the voltage across the capacitor was 0, and you apply a unit step function which is having a discontinuity. And you understand that having a discontinuity in the natural time domain is similar to apply a high frequency component to the system itself, because whenever you find some abrupt discontinuity in any of the waveform, that gives rise to a high frequency component within the signal. And already in the last lecture, we have established that this network, this RC network, is for a low pass filter. That means it will not allow any high frequency component. So whenever you find any abrupt variation like this, whenever you find any abrupt variation, so if I assume that, so that is the input signal. So at t is equal to 0, at t is equal to 0, there is an abrupt variation, abrupt discontinuity. For t less than 0, the output input voltage was 0, and for t greater than 0, the input voltage equal to V. So at t is equal to 0, there is abrupt discontinuity. So it gives rise to a high frequency component. And that you can also verify just by finding out the corresponding Laplace transform of the signal. So that abrupt variation is not at all supported by this network because it's a low pass filter ultimately. However, the output voltage, the initial output voltage across the capacitor at t is equal to 0, it was 0. If I assume that the initial voltage is equal to 0, then the property of the capacitor says that the voltage across the capacitor cannot change instantaneously. So initially, if the voltage is equal to 0, then even if with this abrupt variation of the input voltage, the output voltage across the capacitor cannot change abruptly. So the ultimate voltage, we know the ultimate voltage which the capacitor wants to get is equal to V. The ultimately capacitor wants to get charged up to V, which is the magnitude of the input signal, but it will do it gradually, not abruptly, because it's a low pass network. So capacitor will charge up gradually and ultimately it will reach to a value of V. Now whether it can reach to a final value V at a very fast rate or at a very slow rate, that obviously depends upon these two parameters, this R and this C. So depending upon this R and C, and more specifically depending on the product of this R and C, that is RC value, we can understand whether the capacitor can charge to the peak value, to the V, at a first rate or at a slow rate. But however, the initial voltage of the capacitor, if it is like 0, then the output voltage will start increasing from 0. And as you understand here, this is nothing but an exponential increase. So V into 1 minus e to the power minus t by RC. Now, if you just plot this one, then it will be something like that. It's an exponential variation. And ultimately, it will reach to the peak value, something like that. Right? So I think, it seems that it crosses this one. Not at all. It will not cross. It gets saturated to V. So it's something like that. I think let me be. Okay. Yeah. I think you can understand the philosophy behind that. Anyway. So now, whether the increase to the final value is obtained at a very fast rate or at a very slow rate, that essentially depends upon the R and C product. And in connection to that, there is an important parameter which is known as the rise time to any RC network. So what is meant by rise time? So whenever the input signal is applied to the system like this, so the output gets increased from its initial value to of V initial to a final value of V final. Now, the time required by the circuit to reach 90% of its peak from the 10% of its peak is known as the rise time. So here the peak is at V. So if I point out that, okay, this is my 0.1 0.1 times of V. So if this is 0.1 V, and if this is 0.9 V, for example, then you can easily identify these two time. So let me call this time as T1. When the output signal reaches to the 10% of its peak, and suppose this is 90%, and let me call this to be T2. So rise time is defined as the difference between T2 and T1. So how to calculate the rise time? So once again, we have to rely on the equation, that is V out T, output voltage, is given by V into 1 minus e to the power minus T by RC. That is the basic equation to deal with. Now at T is equal to T1, this V out is equal to 0.1 V. So I can write 0.1 V is equal to V into 1 minus e to the power minus T1 upon RC. and 0.1 v by v, it will give you like 0.1. So ultimately, 1 minus e to the power, so 1 minus e to the power minus t1 by rc is equal to 0.1, and which says e to the power minus t1 upon rc is equal to 0.9. So e to the power minus t1 by rc 0.9, so e to the power t1 by rc is given by 1 upon 0.9, and that is equal to 1.11. Now if you take natural log, then it will give you t1 by rc is equal to natural log of 1.11, and if you calculate, this value comes out to be 0.1. That comes out to be 0.1. So from that we can say t1 is equal to 0.1 times rc. Similarly, for the calculation of t2, we can follow the same analogy, and then we should apply the left hand side of the equation. It should be 0.9 v, that is equal to v into 1 minus e to the power minus t2 by rc. Then it will become 0.9. then you can easily understand e to the power minus t2 by rc, that is equal to 0.1, and so e to the power t2 by rc will be equal to 10. And once again, if you take logarithm, natural logarithm, both sides of the equation, then t2 by rc will be equal to ln 10, and if you put the value, it is coming close to 2.3. And from that, we can easily write it down, t2 is equal to 2.3 times rc. So t1 and t2 have already been calculated. So the rise time, the expression for the rise time, tr, which is nothing but the difference between t2 and t1, is given by 2.2 rc. So this rise time, once again, I'm coming back to this slide. So ultimately, what you have seen, the rise time, which is the time taken by the circuit to reach from 10% of the final value to the 90% of the final value, is a function of the R and C component. So if the individual value of this R and C, if they are large enough, then obviously the rise time will be large. And on the other hand, if this R and C, if this product is small enough, then the rise time will be small. So what is the physical significance of that? If the individual value of R and C, or their product, if this RC product is small, then we say that the output voltage can make a transition from its 10% of peak value to the 90% of the peak value at a very fast rate, because the time requirement is very small if the RC product is small. On the other hand, if the RC product is large, that means the time required for the circuit to reach from 10% of its final to 90% of its final is also large, then we can say that the circuit is slow. So depending upon the product of R and C, so we can say that large RC means it's a slow circuit, and small RC means it's a fast circuit. So large RC means it's a slow circuit, because the capacitor can charge up to its peak value of capital V after a very longer period of time. On the other hand, if this RC product is small, then it can charge up to its peak value at a very fast rate. So depending upon this R and C product, the behavior of the circuit is heavily dependent However, whether we select a lower RC value or higher RC value, the behavior of the circuit is of a low pass. Always, it will exhibit a low pass response. But whether it's a fast circuit or it's a slow circuit, that heavily depends upon the RC product. So RC product plays a very vital role over here in characterizing the circuit, in identifying the behavior of the circuit, whether it's a fast one or slow one. Then what happens if I put or if I select a time value to be equal to RC? What I mean to say is that we have already got this expression that V out T is equal to V into 1 minus e to the power minus T by RC. So we have already seen that the rise time TR is proportional to RC. RC product. So this R and C, this product, is having some implication with the time. So what happens if I put the T is equal to RC? So if I put T is equal to RC, then V out T with T is equal to RC, this V out T is given by V into 1 minus e to the power minus 1. So if you put the value of e to the power minus 1, so it will be close to 0.368, that value, 0.368, and 1 minus that. So ultimately, it is 0.632 V. Then from that analysis, you can have another implication about this RC product. So it is the time. This RC, this is also known as RC time constant. It is the time. So I think it will be better if I just once again draw the output pattern. So T versus V out T. So let us, this is the final level, which the capacitor is aiming to reach. And this is the variation. So it looks something like that. So starting from T is equal to zero. So if I mark this point to be say 63.2 or 0.632, so let this be placed over here, 0.632 V. This is the time. So that time is equal to RC. And this is known as the time constant of the circuit, and sometimes it is denoted by tau. So if the circuit is, if this RC product is small enough, then obviously the output voltage can reach to its 63.2% of its final value, peak value, very quickly. And on the other hand, if this RC product is large enough, then it will take more time for the circuit to reach to the 63.2% of its peak value. So this time constant and rise time, they are directly proportional to the product of R and C. And last day, what you have seen is the higher cutoff frequency, FH, pertaining to the circuit, and that is inversely proportional to RC. It was like 1 by twice pi RC. So once again, there is a relationship between this FH and this TR. So let me just establish the relationship. So today we have seen that FH equal to 1 upon twice pi RC. So if RC product is large, then this FH will be small. The higher cutoff frequency will be small. The cutoff frequency will be directed towards the zero frequency. And on the other hand, if this RC product is small, then this higher cutoff frequency will be shifted towards the higher side, towards the right hand side. And what you have seen, this TR is given by 2.3 2 times RC. So if we just multiply them together, FH and TR, FH gets multiplied with TR, then it is 1 by 2 pi RC multiplied with 2.2 RC. You know that pi is equal to 22 by upon 7. So this 22 gets cancelled. You have 7 into 0.1, that is 0.7 by 2. That is 0.35 ultimately, this product. Or we can write this TR, rise time, is given by 0.35 upon FH. And sometimes this FH is also known as the bandwidth of this RC low pass network. So it is given by 0.35 upon the bandwidth. So this rise time and the bandwidth, they are inversely proportional to each other for any RC. Whether you select a lower RC or you select a higher RC, the product is of this TR and FH, that is remaining always constant, and that value is equal to 0.35. So if you make any attempt to increase the rise time, then automatically the bandwidth will get decreased and vice versa, so that the product remains constant. So that is all about the behavior of the circuit whenever you apply a simple step function. Now what happens whenever, instead of applying a step function, if I apply a simple pulse? So what is the difference between a step function and a pulse? So let us just observe the difference pictorially. So let me just draw two such waveforms. Let me just draw two such waveforms. One is a step function, which looks something like that. I think, it is not a conventional method to draw any waveform. So let's rewrite this. So this is the step function. And whenever you talk about pulse, Vt. So whenever I talk about pulse, so it is something like that. So pulse is having a width. So let this width be represented by capital T. So for a pulse waveform, the input signal Vt can be represented like that is equal to V. If I mark this point with V, that is equal to V for 0 less than equal to t less than equal to capital T, and that is equal to 0 otherwise. So that is the small difference with respect to unit step function. But however, we can easily find out, or we can easily generate this pulse waveform from a step function. How to generate a pulse waveform from a step function? Suppose the step function is represented by, let it be say V step T. Then this pulse waveform Vt can be represented like, say, let it be V step T, a step function. Up to 0 to T, there is no problem. But beyond T, the value of this pulse waveform becomes 0. So we have to apply a negative step of same amplitude, but applied at t is equal to capital T. So t minus capital T. So this pulse waveform, can be represented by the summation, because this abstraction can also be regarded as a summation, of two step function having equal amplitude, but applied at two different times. The first step is applied at t is equal to 0, and the second step is applied at t is equal to capital T, and we have to subtract the second from the first. Then we can identify the corresponding pulse waveform Now the next question is that if I would like to find out the response of the circuit, the same RC circuit, because of this pulse waveform, shall I go for a KVL or shall I go for applying KVL once again, as we have done last time, or whether I should invoke some of the properties of a linear network? In fact, this network is also time invariant. So what is meant by time invariant circuit? Let me just briefly point it out over here. So if a network is time invariant, that means the output or the response of the network, response of the system, depends only on the input and on the system, not on the time at which the input is applied. For example, if I consider a simple resistance like this, if I apply a voltage across a resistance, then the current, suppose we have a resistance R, and suppose the voltage drop is equal to V, then the current that is going to flow through this resistance is always given by V upon R, as far as Ohm's law is concerned. Instead of considering a resistance, if I have a capacitor over here, and if I maintain a voltage drop of C, voltage drop of V across the two plates of the capacitor, whose capacitance value is equal to C, then you know what about the current. That current, as you know, this current is given by I is equal to C dV dt. So that is always true. Irrespective of the time, whenever we apply the input, whether we apply the input t is equal to 0, or we apply the input t is equal to t1, or we apply the input t is equal to t2, it doesn't matter. The response of the circuit, a response of the device, response of the system depends only on the type of the input and obviously on the device or on the system itself, not on the time when you apply the input. That means the response of the system or response of the network, response of the circuit, is completely insensitive to the time at which the input is applied. So whether we apply the input at t is equal to 0 or t is equal to t1, t is equal to t, doesn't matter. And that is a property of a time invariant system. And in fact, the system, the RC circuit, what we have discussed so far, is a time invariant system, and you can easily verify this one. So last day, we've already seen that this network is a linear system, linear network, and this network is also time invariant. So therefore, ultimately, this network is a linear time invariant system, or LTI system. So for a LTI system, if I know the response of the network, or response of the system, or response of the circuit, for an input of V step T, then because of this linearity property, because of the additivity property, and because of this time invariance property, we know what will be the response of the system, response of the network, because of this combined input, V step T minus V step T minus capital T. So we know that what is the output due to V step T. So let me just mark this network, mark this system by means of a black box, say RC network. Let me call it RC network, RC low pass network, as we're talking about. The input is, say, let it be V step T. That is input. Let us assume that the initial voltage across the capacitor, initial output voltage, is equal to 0. So then the output is given by, if I call this is V out T, so that is given by V into 1 minus e to the power minus T by RC. So therefore, if I apply say another input, which is equal to say V step T minus capital T, then the corresponding output should be, if I call this to be say V out, I should write T because it's a function of T, then it is given by V into 1 minus e to the power minus T minus capital T by RC. In isolation, that means whenever I apply these two input separately, if I apply V step T, the output should be V into 1 minus E minus T by RC. If I apply V step T minus capital T separately, then the output should be V into 1 minus E minus T minus capital T by RC. Now, whenever I apply a combined input like V step T minus V step T minus capital T, the overall output can be regarded not as a combination, not as a simple difference between these two. Why? Because while getting this particular equation, that output is equal to V into 1 minus e to the power minus t by RC, we have made one assumption. The assumption was that the initial voltage across the capacitor, initial output voltage equal to zero. But that may not be true always. And in fact, whenever we apply a pulse waveform like this, the initial output voltage across the capacitor at t is equal to capital T is never zero. So therefore, whenever we consider this combined input as a pulse input like this, then the overall response will be a little bit different, but that can be easily computed if I would follow the linearity property of this particular network. So instead of going into the mathematical calculation, let me just start with the observing the response of the system. So the governing equations will be the same. So let me write over here Vt only. Whether it's input or output, you can easily understand. Let me first draw the pulse. So this is your V in T. So V in T is input signal, which is defined like V in T is equal to V for 0 less than equal to T less than equal to capital T, and that is equal to 0 otherwise. So that is input signal which we are going to apply. And this is capital T, which is also known as the width of the pulse. This is 0, this is capital T. Then first of all, we have to observe the output voltage or pattern of the output voltage within this particular window between 0 to capital T. So let me take a different color. So let me say V out T. So that is the output voltage. So let us assume that the initial voltage across the capacitor is equal to 0 and the peak value is equal to V, then obviously it will start increasing from 0 and it will try to reach capital T using a exponential curve. So at T is equal to capital T, it can reach up to this much. And what is that value? So if I call that value to be say let this value to be say V1, for example, if this value equal to V1, then we know that V out T, I think I have already written over there. V out T can be represented like V into 1 minus e to the power minus T by RC between 0 to capital T, because it will follow this exponential nature. Then what should be the V1? So V1 is given by V into 1 minus e to the power minus capital T by RC, because here the time is equal to capital T, small t is equal to capital T. And then at t is equal to capital T, small t is equal to capital T, you are going to apply the next pulse of equal amplitude but in opposite direction. That means you are going to apply V step T minus capital T. Now, while applying V step T minus capital T, remember now the output voltage across the capacitor, the initial output voltage is not equal to zero. Rather, the initial output voltage across the capacitor is equal to V1. So if I draw the RC network once again over here for your convenience. So basically we are applying two different inputs at two different time. The shape of the input being the same, applying a pulse waveform of duration capital T of width capital T is equivalent to applying one unit step one step function of amplitude V of say at t is equal to zero and applying another step function of amplitude minus V at t is equal to capital T. And these two signals are these two signals are applied at two different times. One is applied at t is equal to zero and the second one is applied at t is equal to capital T. So we cannot follow the same expression because the initial and the initial value and the final value of these two output voltage will be different. Whenever we are going to apply the first pulse or first signal, that is the step function, which is applied at t is equal to zero, the target output voltage is equal to plus V. And the initial output voltage equal to zero for the capacitor. So therefore it starts increasing from zero and the target voltage equal to capital T. So it will follow this path. And at T is equal to capital T, it can reach up to V1, for example. So this V1 can be greater than V, V1 can be equal to V or it can be less than V. So here we have seen that V1 is less than V, but cannot exceed V because that is a target voltage, target output voltage. So V1, the maximum value for V1 could be V. So depending upon the time constant, this RC, and depending upon the value of this capital T, so it can be equal to V or can be less than V. So here, for example, let us assume that the time constant is large with respect to this capital T so that the output voltage cannot reach to V, but to a value V1, which is less than V. And this output voltage serves as the output voltage at t is equal to capital T serves as the initial voltage of the capacitor whenever you are going to apply the next pulse of opposite and equal magnitude. So then the next pulse, if I consider and if I call, I think it will be better if I use anyway. So let it be V out one. So let me mark like V out one T, and the next pulse is like V out two T. So the next pulse is V out two T. So that is equal to. So let me once again go back to that expression. What you have got? It was like V final minus V final minus V initial in due to the power minus T by RC. So that expression. So V final minus V final minus V initial into e to the power minus T by RC. So that is the expression for V out 2T. So that expression is valid for the second one. And remember, that is being applied at T is equal to capital T. That is applied at T is equal to capital T. So here the initial voltage is given by V1. So V1 is initial voltage across the capacitor or across the output node. And what is the target value? So basically, if I observe this rectangular pulse. It is something like that. You have applied this one, and let me have another one. This one. This is small t. This is capital T. At t is equal to capital T, you have applied and another pulse, another function, step function, a delayed step function, whose amplitude is equal to minus V. So here the capacitor will be targeting for an output voltage or for a peak voltage to be minus V because of this one, and this is applied at T is equal to capital T. So therefore, we can put the value V final is equal to minus V and V initial is equal to V1, and accordingly the corresponding variation beyond this point, beyond this T is equal to capital T, will look something like that. Beyond T is equal to capital T, it will follow an exponential nature. It will follow an exponential nature. And ultimately, it will decay to zero. So if I consider this to be V out 1t, which is defined for 0 to capital T, and let this be V out, so this one is V out 1t. And suppose this is V out 2t. And this V out 2t is given by, if you do some calculation, some mathematical calculation over here, then it is given by V1. So that is the starting value over here. Multiplied with 1 minus e to the power minus t minus capital T by RC. That means the value of V out T at T is equal to capital T is equal to, I have made a mistake over here. Since it's an exponential variation, so it will be like V1 into e to the power minus T minus capital T upon RC. So at T is equal to capital T, the corresponding value, and this is defined for T greater than or equal to capital T. So if you put T is equal to capital T, then the value will be equal to V1 into e to the power 0, that is equal to V1 over here. And then gradually, as T increases, then obviously it will decay. And for a very high value of this small t, ultimately the output voltage drops down to 0. So now here we have assumed that the value of the time constant is comparable, or at least not that small, so that this output voltage over here gets saturated to V1, V. But depending upon the, so here we have assumed that this time constant of the circuit, T and tau, they are comparable. T and RC, they are comparable. Comparable T and RC. Or I may assume that T and RC, they are comparable. T and RC, comparable T and RC. Let me just write it down over here. So this has been drawn for comparable T and RC. Now what happens if the time constant is small enough? If the time constant is small enough, then obviously this output voltage can reach to the peak at a very fast rate. So this is the time axis. So this is the target. I think I mean just to so if the time constant is small enough with respect to the pulse width, so this is capital T, and let us assume that this RC value is small with respect to this capital T, then it may reach to the peak. It may reach to the peak before capital T, and then the V1, which we have marked earlier, that is nothing but capital V, and then the output voltage drops like this. So here, if I mark this as V01T, and if I call this to V02T, then V01T follows the same expression, that is V into 1 minus e to the power minus T by RC. But here, since the RC value is less than capital T, then this e to the power minus T by RC, this entire thing could have been considered to be 0. For T is equal to capital T, and ultimately this V01T is equal to V at T is equal to capital T, even for T less than capital T. And beyond this value, beyond this capital T, this V02T is given by V into e to the power minus T by RC. So as time increases, the corresponding amplitude decays, and ultimately it will, for a very high value of time, for a very large value of time, then ultimately V02 drops down to 0. And that is defined over T greater than. And this is defined for T greater than or equal to capital T. But to make sense, I think here we should put T minus capital T, because we have shifted the time. So it is nothing but T minus capital T upon RC. So if I put T is equal to capital T over here, then e to the power 0, that is 1, and V. So it drops like that. So that is the expression for V02T. The only difference is that here the capacitor gets discharged from a value of capital V. Last time we have seen that the capacitor gets discharged from value of V1, which is less than capital V. But this time, since the time constant is small with respect to time, with respect to this pulse width, that is capital T, so therefore the operational circuit is fast because of the application of this pulse waveform to the input of this RC network. The circuit can respond at a very fast rate because the time constant is small, RC is small, RC product is small. So the let me go back to this slide. Yeah. So small RC means the response should be fast. So since the RC product is small, so therefore the circuit can respond at a very fast rate, and it can reach to the peak value of capital V before small t is equal to capital T. Now you can have even a stringent situation where this RC product is much, much smaller than capital T. So under this condition, it will be something like that. So then it's a very fast, it's very fast. I think it will be better if I just change the color of this one so that it can make sense. the green with RC less than capital T and the red with RC very, very less than capital T. In both of these two cases, the peak value from which the capacitor gets discharged at T is equal to capital T is equal to V, but the rate of discharge is different. I think it will be even more sharper. It should be even more sharper. Let this be like this. But in any case, the pulse is applied between 0 to capital T. But even if RC time constant is much, much smaller as compared to capital T, but the output signal is existing beyond the capital T. What you can find over here, even if the RC value is much, much smaller as compared to the pulse width, that is capital T, there is a presence of the output voltage beyond capital T. So the output spreads over and above capital T. But if the time constant is small, it's much, much smaller as compared to the time pulse width, then the corresponding output response resulting from the circuit, it can replicate the input signal to some extent. Obviously, there is a distortion. Whether you select RC is less than T or RC very, very less than T, there is a distortion. There is no doubt about that. But whether the distortion is small or distortion is large, that can be appreciated just by observing the value of RC with respect to capital T. If the value of RC is comparable, as we have seen over here, if the value of RC is comparable with capital T, then there is a significant distortion. This green curve cannot be treated to be a pulse waveform, right? On the other hand, if the time constant is small and very, very small with respect to the time pulse width, that is capital T, and then we find that obviously there is a distortion. Now, output voltage cannot instantaneously rise to a value of capital V at T is equal to 0, T greater than 0. It will take some time. That time is obviously dependent upon the product, RC product. And obviously, beyond capital T, it cannot momentarily come down to 0. It will take some time to come down to 0 from this capital T. But however, there is a distortion, but if the time constant is small, then the circuit can respond at a fast rate, and to some extent, the distortion can be minimized. So that is the response of the RC circuit because of the application of a pulse pattern. Now, let us check what will be the performance of the circuit, what will be the behavior of the circuit whenever we apply square wave signal. So square wave signal means we are applying the pulses one after another. So it is something like that. For a square wave, if I represent this to say Vt, so the variation is something like that. So there are two different levels. One level is set at V1, the other level is set at V2. So suppose this one is V1, this level, and this level is V2. And obviously the time differences are also not the same. So this time is say T1, and this time is T2. It can be same, but intentionally I'm putting it to be unequal. So on time is T1. Sometimes it is known as on time. This is known as off time. If I put V1 is equal to some value V and V2 is equal to 0, then it's a simple NRZ kind of pulse pattern. And then T1 is on time, T2 is off time. But to make sense, if I want to make it general, then for any rectangular pulse, rectangular waveform, we have two different levels. One is at V1 and the second one is at V2. So sometimes that V1 can be equated to, say, capital V, and this V2 can be equated to zero. So that depends. Sometimes the V2 can be negative also, in which case you have a bipolar kind of pulse pattern. And if I assume that this T1 and T2, they are same, equal, then ultimately it will be treated as a simple square wave signal. So assume that T1 and T2, they are unequal. But if T1 is equal to T2, if they are same, then it gives rise to a square wave. If V2 is equal to zero, then it means it's a unipolar. And if V2 is equal to negative, V2 zero, or I should mention like V2 zero or greater than zero. If V2 is equal to zero, then the notion of on and off will be there. V2 is greater than zero, then unipolar. And if V2 is negative, V2 is less than zero, then it should be bipolar. V2 less than zero and V1 greater than zero, then it means bipolar. So there are different notions about that. So these two together, bipolar. Anyway, so accordingly, you can also find out the duty cycle on period divided by the total period, that is T1 plus T2. Anyway, for this kind of input, if the input is something like that, as you understand, initially I started with a simple step function. And then from the step function, what you have derived is a pulse pattern. That means we are just applying one such period like this, one such window. And now this gets repeated one after another, T1, T2, T1, T2, like this. Then what will be the pattern? How can we write down the expression? So mathematical expression, you can easily write it down. There is no harm about that. So for the particular mathematical operation, you have to identify the initial voltage. You need to identify the initial voltage across the capacitor. And accordingly, there could have been two different wave shape, one for 0 to T1, or rather one for a duration of T1, and the second one is for a duration of T2. So if I just, okay, I can draw it over here, no problem. Or I can also go to the next slide. I think it will be better. So let us assume that we have two different levels, as we have done earlier, and that is V1 and V2. So these are the two levels. V1 is a level for which the wave shape remains for a duration of T1, and V2 is a level, another level, for which the wave shape remains for duration of T2, the input wave shape. So I think fine. So this is the time axis. So let it be V in T. So whenever I draw V in T, so it should be with the blue. Just like this. Just small, make it smaller itself. Yeah, now fine. So accordingly, we have to draw two different waveforms, one between this duration with a duration of say T1. So let me mark this as V1 and this level at V2, as we have marked last time. So this is V2 and this is T1, and this point is T1 plus T2, because this duration is T2. This duration is T1 and this duration is T2. So for duration of T1, the input pattern stays at V1, and for duration of T2, the input pattern stays at V2. Then obviously we have to mark two different levels. I mean, the initial voltage across the capacitor, initial output voltage, whenever we are going to apply each of these two levels separately. Now let us assume that at T is equal to zero, the voltage across the capacitor, let this be marked by some V dashed. So at T is equal to zero, when you start from this point, suppose this voltage, so this is V dashed. So V dashed is nothing but, so let me mark over here, V dashed is the voltage across capacitor at T is equal to zero. And then obviously it will follow the same waveform, same pattern, the exponential increase. And this voltage is equal to, so let this voltage be V double dashed. So V double dashed, we can say, this is the voltage across the capacitor. Voltage across the capacitor at T is equal to say T1. So now, first of all, we can write down the expression over here. We can have two different portion. One is the rising portion, second one is the falling portion. So for the rising portion, we know what is the target value. The target value is obviously V1, that is the final value. And what about the initial value? The initial voltage equal to V dashed. So if I call this to be V01, the rising V01t, so we know that V01t can be represented, or can be written like the target value is V1. So we have a target value V1, a final value V1 minus V1 minus the initial value, that is V dashed, into e to the power minus T by RC. And that is defined over 0 to T1. Similarly, if I consider the second slot from this point to that point over a duration of T2, so now the target value is equal to V2 and the initial value is equal to V double dashed. So if the pattern is given by V02, so not to make sense, so it should be over here, because at T is equal to T2, once again the voltage across the capacitor will be equal to V dashed, as long as this T1 and T2 are maintained properly. And this one is V02t. Now, as you understand, V02t is applied at T is equal to T1. So here, what is the final value? The target value is V2. So for V02t, the target value is V2 and the initial value is v double dashed the e to the power minus, so you should write t minus capital T by RC. And this is defined over T1 less than equal to T less than equal to T1 plus T2. So the only unknown quantity over here is V dashed and V double dashed, but you can readily calculate this one, these two parameters. Because in this entire expression of V01T and V02T, all you know is the V1, you know V2, you know T1, you know T2, but you don't have any idea regarding V dashed and V double dashed. So how to calculate V dashed and V double dashed? So this V dashed is nothing but, if I follow this expression, the second expression, and if I put a value of T is equal to T1 plus T2, if I put a value of T is equal to T1 plus T2, then V02T, the value of V02T is nothing but V dashed. And how to calculate V double dashed? The value of V01T at T is equal to capital T. So one can easily calculate, or one can easily find it out, these two different parameters. So V01, or rather this V, so V dashed is equal to V02T at T is equal to T1 plus T2. So if I follow that expression, if I follow that graph over here, so the value of V02T at T is equal to T1 plus T2 is nothing but V dashed. And similarly for V double dashed, this is nothing but V01T at T is equal to capital T. So accordingly, you have to put a value of T is equal to T1 over here. So T is equal to T1. So you need to put a value of T is equal to T1 in this equation. Equation number one, if I say, and equate the left-hand side with V double dashed. And here, you equate the left-hand side with the V dashed by putting a value of T is equal to T1 plus T2. So then you have two equations with two unknowns. What are the two unknowns? V dashed and V double dashed. Other quantities are known. V1, V2, and T1, T2, R and C. So all of them are known. And ultimately, from these two equations, you can eliminate and calculate the V dashed and V double dashed, and you can put the value over here. And accordingly, this wave shape can be obtained. Now, depending upon the relative value between T1, T2, and RC product, there is a possibility that this V dashed can be equal to V2, or it is higher than V2. Similarly, the value of V double dashed can be equal to V1, or it can be less than V1. So it depends upon the time constant. So if the time constant, RC time constant, is comparable with T1 and T2, then the wave shape looks something like that. And if the RC time constant is small enough, then it can be like this. If the RC time constant is small enough, then it can reach like this. So that is for small RC time constant. In fact, it will start from V2 itself. And it will be something like that. And then it is there at V2. And then once again, that is only possible. So this is only possible when with the smaller RC, when the RC time constant is small, then only you can achieve this one. And what happens when the time constant is large enough? When the time constant is large enough with respect to this, then you can have this exponential nature. Ultimately, what you can show here is that this e to the power minus t by rc, this particular thing. Now if I assume that this time constant, rc time constant, is large enough, right? So then e to the power minus t by rc, that entire thing. So I think it will be better if I say something over here. So if rc time constant is much, much larger with respect to t1 and t2, then in both the equations you have an exponential term, right? You have an expression like v1 minus v1 minus v dashed into e to the power minus t by rc. So this is the time dependent parameter, e to the power minus t by rc. The other parameters are completely some constant quantity. Here also you have v2 minus some v2 minus v double dashed into e to the power minus t minus capital T by rc. So this time varying quantity is e to the power minus t by rc. Now if the time constant rc is much, much larger as compared to t1 and t2, then in the expression we have e to the power minus t by rc. If I just consider, so you know that that can be written like e to the power x can be written like 1 plus x plus x square factorial 2 and so on. But if this t by rc, that particular ratio, if that ratio is much small, for rc to be much, much larger as compared to t1 and t2, then this t by rc ratio is small enough, then e to the power minus x can be approximated to 1 minus x only. So you don't have these higher order terms, x square, x cube, x to the power 4 and so on. So those higher order terms will be just eliminated. We can just neglect those higher order terms because this t by rc, that ratio is very small. So x square, x cube, x to the power 4, so these higher order terms can be neglected with respect to 1. So then ultimately you have this 1 minus x expression, and x is nothing but this t by rc. Then ultimately for very larger time constant, then it's not like that. So for a larger time constant, it will be something like that. So time constant is very large, so the capacitor will take much time to get charged from v2 to v1 or v1 to v2, to get discharged from v1 to v2. So it will be like this. So what you are getting is the variation with respect to time is a linear one, because 1 minus x is there. So ultimately the variation of Vt, the output voltage with respect to time, is a linear one, linear quantity with respect to time. So the variation will be linear like this. And another interesting point to note here is, you have applied in square wave input like this, or rectangular wave input like this. And what you're getting is a kind of triangular waveform. So your input is a constant, like say constant values, say V, and your output is like some alpha times V times T. So the input is constant with the duration of T1, the input is constant, is kept constant V1, and within the duration of T2, the input is kept constant at V2. So the input is always constant, whether the output increases and decreases linearly. So it's a triangular waveform. So we can consider that the input is constant. Input is constant in each of these two windows, within the duration of T1 and within the duration of T2. However, the output is linear. Output is linear. So constant to linear. So if you have some constant value, some alpha, and if you have something like alpha t, so that can only be obtained if you go for integration. If you have a function like, let me consider that f of x is equal to some alpha. And if you integrate this f of x dx, then ultimately you have some, or like alpha x plus c. indefinite integration. So constant to linear, that particular transformation or that particular description is obtained by this particular circuit. So for this network, RC network, with the RC time constant is much, much larger with respect to T1 and T2, if we provide a constant input, the output shape is a linear one. That means it performs the job of an integration operation. So therefore, under this condition, when RC time constant is much, much larger with respect to T1 and T2, or rather with respect to the time duration or the time period of the waveform, because T1 plus T2 is the time duration or the time period of the square wave signal or rectangular wave signal. Now, if the time constant is large, then the low-pass filter that we're talking about can be treated as an integrator, which can integrate the signal. Now, that is not only true for the square wave, this is true for other waves as well. So we have so far discussed about the response of the circuit because of a step function, because of a pulse waveform, because of some square wave signal. Now, apart from that, let us take another signal, the signal which you have got right now, the ramp function. Let us consider ramp function. And you know, the ramp function is defined like the input, the ramp with the input RT is given like simply T for T greater than or equal to 0. So that is the simplest description for a ramp function. So if the input is, if this input is applied, so it might be T or it can be having some factor outside, some alpha T, so that you can just tune the slope. So if I make it simply T, then the slope is simply 45 degree. Anyway, you can make it like T or alpha T. You can also make it alpha T. Doesn't make any change, because we are talking about a linear circuit. And for a linear circuit, obviously, we have to follow the additivity and homogeneity property. So under this condition, if I would like to find out the corresponding output whenever we apply this one to this particular circuit. So the circuit remains the same, a simple RC network. VIT, and here VIT is equal to RT, VOUT. So once again, you can follow the differential equation format, or else what you can do is you can simply go into the Laplace domain. And in the Laplace domain, you know the what is the relation between the output voltage and the input voltage. So in the Laplace domain, that is equivalent to simply R. That here you have VIS, here you have VOUTS, and here you have 1 upon SC. So in Laplace domain, what you can write is VOUTS. V out is upon V in S, that is given by, you have to consider these two reactants. Here you have R, here you have 1 upon SC. So this is nothing but 1 upon SC divided by R plus 1 upon SC as far as the voltage division formula is concerned. So 1 upon SC divided by R plus 1 upon SC. So if you multiply it SC, then it will be 1 by 1 plus SRC. And we are interested in finding out V out S. So V out S is equal to V in S into 1 by 1 plus SRC. Now your V in T is equal to some alpha T for T greater than 0. greater than equal to zero. So we suggest that V in S, if we just apply the Laplace transformation over here, then it will give you alpha upon S square. So that is the expression for V in S. So with that, we can go on calculating V out S. So V out S is equal to alpha upon S square into 1 by 1 plus SRC. So from that, what you can do is you can take RC outside so that it will give you some convenient form. Then you are left with 1 by S square into S plus 1 upon RC. Because in the Laplace domain or in the inverse Laplace domain, we are very much fond of this particular form, that is S plus 1 upon RC or S plus some constant. So that's why I've taken this RC outside. So now we have S square into S plus 1 upon RC. So now we can think over here, this entire thing, 1 upon S square into S plus 1 by RC, as you know, the standard form for calculating the inverse Laplace transform is to represent them as a summation of the partial product, so partial fraction. So let it be, say, A by S plus say B by S square plus say C by, I should not use the term C because already you have C here. Rather, instead of having AB, let me write like, okay, let me write like, say A1 by S, A2 by S square, A3 by S plus 1 upon RC. So ultimately, you have to equate the coefficient of S, S square and constant. So S square into S plus 1 upon RC. So now you have A1 S, S plus 1 upon RC plus A2 into S plus 1 upon RC plus A3 S square. So now if you equate, so the coefficient of S square is A1 here, A3 here. So we find that A1 plus A3 is equal to 0. And a coefficient of S is A1 by RC plus A2, that is also 0. And A2 by RC is equal to 1. So which suggests that A2 is equal to RC. If A2 is equal to RC, then A1 is equal to minus RC whole square. And A3 is equal to RC whole square. So we have got these three coefficient. So this V out S, now we can write down V out S as you have some alpha by RC outside and then A1 by S. So A1 is minus RC whole square. So minus RC whole square by S. So minus RC whole square by S. And then you have A2. A2 by S square. And A2 is equal to RC. So RC by S square. RC by S square. and then a3, so a3 is rc whole square by s plus 1 upon rc. So that is the expression in the Laplace domain, and then you have to represent them in the natural time domain. So what you can do is you can take this RC inside now. So then it is equal to minus alpha RC by S plus alpha upon S square plus alpha RC by S plus 1 upon RC. So taking inverse Laplace, Laplace inverse, if I apply, then I'll be getting V out T. So this minus alpha RC by S, so this is nothing but simply minus alpha RC into ut, plus you have alpha a square, alpha by a square. So if you have alpha by a square, so then this alpha by a square will be given like alpha into t. So it will be alpha into t, and then you have alpha rc into e to the power minus t by rc. So then it can be written like, or it can be simplified to alpha into t minus rc plus alpha rc into e to the power minus t by rc. So this is the final expression for the output voltage. You have two terms basically. One is alpha into t minus rc, and that increases linearly with the time, and the second quantity is alpha rc into e to the power minus t by rc. So these two quantity we have, alpha into t minus rc, which is a linear function of time, and the second part is alpha rc into e to the power minus t by rc. And if I assume that this T by RC, that ratio is large enough, then this e to the power minus T by RC can be neglected. Or in other words, if the time constant is very small, which is our requirement, always we want that the circuit should be fast enough. Now, if RC time constant is small enough, small RC, if I consider small RC, it gives rise to e to the power minus T by RC. It can be approximated to zero. So for any practical circuit, we always want to achieve a very small value of RC, the time constant. So under this condition, this e to the power minus t by RC can be neglected, can be zero, can be made zero. And then under this condition, V out t is given by alpha into t minus RC. So basically, you are provided an input of alpha into t, that is the step input, that is a ramp input. So this is t input, if I consider v in t, so it's something like that. And if I consider the output voltage, v out, so it is nothing but alpha into t minus rc. Under this condition, v out t, the condition is that rc time constant, rc is small, so the second term can be neglected. This alpha rc into t minus t by rc can be neglected. So only have the first term, so the same function, but it is delayed by some rc. So for t is equal to zero, the value will be negative. or t is equal to, the value will be negative. It's like close to minus alpha RC, and then it can be considered to be parallel, and the difference is given by, so with the second term neglected, the value can be negative. But if the second term is not neglected, and then it starts from zero and it looks something like that. And that difference, that time difference between these two, so this one is your input, this one is output, and that time difference between these two, so that time difference is RC. So as you understand, the input and the output under this condition, they are almost comparable as far as their nature is concerned, because in one case you have only alpha t and other case you have only alpha into t minus RC. But the thing is that you have neglected the next part, the second part, assuming that this time constant is much, much smaller as compared to the applied time. But however, if this condition is not satisfied, that RC is not small, then you don't get this kind of waveform. Then the waveform will be seriously distorted, and you have an exponential kind of increase. For example, if I do not follow anything, if I just consider a simple variation, say this is Vt. So this is the input signal, for example. And if I do not allow that this e to the power minus t by RC is approximate to zero, that means if I assume a comparable value of RC, then under this condition, the wave shape is seriously distorted, and it will be, it is not a linear function of time. Rather, you have an exponential rise. And you have variation like this, because you have e to the power minus t by RC, that part. So that is for a comparable RC. Anyway, so depending upon the individual value for the R and C, the product, and the property of the input signal, the output waveform can be different. Now it is very difficult to draw by hand until and unless you have some sophisticated software to plot this signal. Anyway, but you can have some idea regarding the response. How does it look like whenever you apply this kind of input? And what are the assumptions? What are the limitations that you are allowing in this particular exercise? So with this, I would like to conclude this discussion of RC network, RC low pass network, when it is excited by means of several known input patterns like wave function, pulse waveform, rectangular waveform, and a ramp function. In the next class, I'll be talking about a different type of RC network, which acts like a high pass filter. And accordingly, we will characterize the circuit first, and then we will observe the response of the circuit because of the application of various such inputs like this.